We're going to continue now with a presentation from my business partner, Kev Sheldrake. We basically run head hacking together. Now, I normally confess at this point that Kev Sheldrake was the first person I ever met via an online forum. We've been... It got worse because the second was Vince Lynch. But we were just talking hypnosis and we shared an interest in a particular kind of magic called mentalism and mind reading, that kind of stuff, which Harry's going to demonstrate later on. And that eventually led to us both being on a stage hypnosis course. And after that, when I got some opportunities to perform, and needed, you know, someone standing by my side working on stuff with me, Kevin and I started working together at that point. And that became, you know, a more formal business partnership. And essentially, everything you've seen me do performance-wise, we work on together. Kev is one of those terribly annoying people with an equally large right brain and left brain. So he can write and produce and direct and all that stuff, but he's also, you know, got the analytical skills and deals with a lot of the detail in terms of the production of our products and DVDs and things. After looking at various theories of hypnosis and essentially all of our training being based around no history and no theory, we just knew what we did worked. About 2 years ago, we started to look a little more closely at the cognitive behavioral realm of hypnosis, and that's really where Kev's talk is going to head today. And that involved looking at some of the science. Now, I'm no scientist, and, you know, I'm no accountant either, and I get equally turned off as soon as I see a chart and a graph that I don't quite understand. I would encourage all of you, if you're like me in that department, to do not switch off throughout this talk. There is some information peppered throughout this talk that has had a profound effect on the way I do therapy and on the way I do performance, but more importantly, how I think hypnosis works. And that's come from, you know, if you like, learning, not just to look at papers and find the gems, but learning to read them, learning to understand them. So without further ado, I'm going to ask for a big round of applause for Head Hacking's Kev Sheldrake.
You saw the needle that went through that guy's hand. It's over a millimetre thick. Just wanted to draw attention to it with the ability to zoom in. That's one of our tiny badges. You can see how big the needle is in comparison to that. So that's more impressive than anything I'm talking about. But anyway, on the way here today, I saw a terrible sight. Laying in the gutter was a small, dead, baby ghost. But it might have been a handkerchief. There aren't many good jokes about hypnosis, so I've had to borrow some from Jimmy Carr and Milton Jones, who wrote the handkerchief dead ghost joke. So here you clearly tell it better than I could. But then that's it, it's his job, so I'm kind of going half the route there. If I steal the jokes, there's a half a chance I'll get a laugh. If I write them myself. Actually, I did write one joke for this, but Anthony won't let me tell it. It involved your mum. So at Head Hacking, aim is to deliver the best in hypnosis training, products, and performance. And to deliver the best, I think you have to have some clue about how hypnosis works. I think there's a myth out there that there's no science in hypnosis, or the science of hypnosis is particularly poor. It's normally perpetuated by people who've never read any of the science. Quite easy, just ask them, what have you read that was rubbish? They generally can't tell you anything. It's a bit like believing in your horoscope and thinking that astronomy is all made up. It's a bit backwards. So my aim today is to try and convince you that there is some value in the science, and that value can make us all better hypnotists. First up, I'd like to introduce Paul Friend. Paul, would you like to come and stand here? Paul is a highly hypnotizable subject. I wouldn't say he's the highest hypnotizable subject, but he is a highly hypnotizable subject. You can just Fair, is it?
Yeah.
So, are you ready to be hypnotised?
Yeah, let's go for it.
Excellent. Good, thanks very much. Take a look at your hand, look at the lines, look at one spot. As that hand moves closer to your face, your eyes begin to chase focus. That's right. And as you become aware, close your eyes and sleep deeper and deeper. Your legs will support you. That's right. Standing there, deeper and deeper. This hand is going to rise up to your face. That's right. Rise up to your face. That's right. Higher and higher. And as it gets there, it might start to seem a bit amusing. You never know. It might put a smile on your face. It might be when you rub those two fingers together. That kind of feeling might appear. Because when it touches your face, you're going to be laughing so loudly and so inappropriately that this lot will know you're hypnotized. That's right. It's going to touch your face. And when it touches your head, I'm going to click my fingers. When I click my fingers, it will be stuck there and you'll stop laughing instantly. Pretty good. Is that hand stuck to your head? You can speak.
Yeah. Yes.
Can you get it off?
No.
Can you look at it? I don't know if you can open your eyes.
Yeah.
Is that your hand?
Yes.
But it's stuck to your head?
Yes.
Is there anything I could do that would help you get that hand off? Obviously, apart from give you suggestions. Is there anything I could do that would help you get that hand off?
Tell me it's not stuck.
No, I'm not going to tell you that. I'm going to tell you it's so stuck that you can't take... I'll offer you money. I don't know. You can see the money, right? If you can touch it, you can have... Oh, well, yeah, obviously. No, this is a good game. No, okay, but we're... Okay, so, Paul, I'm going to click my fingers. Your hand is going to stay stuck to your head, but what's going to be really weird is that my name is going to disappear out of your mind. Anything happen? Did that... There's a little movement there, perhaps. What's your name?
Paul.
Excellent. Do you know where we are?
Yeah.
Where are we?
I think it's Guy's.
That's right, yeah. King's College London Guy's campus. What's my name? What's his name?
It's Anthony.
Exactly. What's my name?
I don't know, it's gone.
Excellent! Sorry, I don't perform a lot, but just... I know, like Barry says, I'm not a genius, because clearly... I'm demonstrating a very simple technique here. So it is just your imagination. You can stop imagining that any time you want, can't you, Paul?
Yeah.
What's my name?
Kev.
Excellent. That worked nicely. So when your hand was on your head and was stuck, could you have got it off? Kind of reflecting on that situation, what did it feel like?
I thought I would have done, but to be honest, I couldn't. I couldn't.
You really tried?
I was really trying.
And for the wallet.
If there was if there was something falling and you had to grab it, would that have changed the situation, do you think?
I'm not sure.
Maybe we should try that one day. And with the amnesia, did my name go through your mind at all?
No, not at all.
You couldn't see it, hear it?
No. It was more of a confusion. I knew I should know it. But it was just kind of at the tip of my tongue, and it was in there somewhere, but I just couldn't get to it.
Mm. And were you doing that? Were you making that happen?
I didn't feel like I was, no.
Feel like you're putting in any effort?
No.
Did you feel, and you felt that you couldn't breach those suggestions by the sound?
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you. If you're a performer, and you want your subjects to be hypnotized, not acting, because no one acts as well as a hypnotized subject. If you're a hypnotherapist, you want your subjects hypnotized, not pretending, because if your therapy relies on the hypnosis working, then if they've been pretending, there's half a chance it won't work. And what do we mean by being hypnotized? It generally comes down to the sense of non-volition, the idea that they couldn't do anything about it. So, two quotes here from Amanda Barnier and Michael Nash, who edited the Oxford Handbook of Hypnosis. This comes from their introduction. The first quote states hypnosis as product. What is the product of hypnosis? It's this sensation that something has changed in the personal experience. The second quote defines hypnosis as process, defines what they considered to be the essential elements, and that was an introduction, which might be, hi, I'm Kev. You don't necessarily need to mention hypnosis. And the first suggestion, which could be sleep. It could be put your hands out like this, your hands will come together. What is missing in that hypnosis as process definition is an induction. And for good reason, because it would preclude all non-induction-based hypnotic phenomena. You'd have to conclude there weren't hypnosis. And even if there is a distinction between the two, they're clearly in the same domain and therefore should be included. And that's why this doesn't preclude that kind of phenomenon. So, the Oxford Handbook of Hypnosis, this is, yeah, as I said, edited by Nash and Barnier. It has chapters on the domain of hypnosis, theoretical perspectives, contemporary research, and clinical hypnosis. And it features many of the leading academics putting forward the different viewpoints and perspectives and interpretations of the evidence around hypnosis. And in this book, in those chapters, often you get to read those perspectives and interpretations from the people who are responsible directly for them. So you are getting their wealth of hundreds and hundreds of academic papers they've written squeezed into a chapter where they kind of interpret for you. It's a very good way of getting a broad understanding of the science of hypnosis and where it starts. I've also, in this talk, I referenced a few academic papers. These are expensive and difficult to read. They do contain the data on which the interpretations are formed and the reasons why those interpretations are formed the way they are. So obviously, if you get to read the papers, you can reinterpret it if you wish. But reading something like the Oxford Handbook, you're reading sort of a meta interpretation, essentially, of all these papers. Reading the paper, the individual papers, you will get the individual data, which can be quite revealing. It's just that if you don't know what you're looking for, you can spend hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pounds before you find it. Unless you have a friend who's a med student, kind of speeds things up a bit. But these three I did pay for, so I do know that these are based on. What's got four legs and goes boo? A cow with a cold. What's got four legs and goes ah? A sheep with no lips. So, these figures are taken from a paper by Irving Kirsch, Christopher Silver, Gail Comey, and Stephen Reed, and they provide the data taken from an experiment using the Stanford Hypnotic Susceptibility Scale, which is the standard, gold standard way of testing people's susceptibility. And what it shows in the highlighted column are the proportion of subjects who pass those suggestions. So we can see 75% of people can do magnetic palms, 64% can do a stiff arm, 52% can do a cataleptic arm, 23% achieve amnesia. There's supposed to be a joke there. But, 22% achieved invisibility. And generally, if you roll the figures, you find 10% fall into this highly hypnotizable category who can do most of these suggestions, and 10% fall into the low hypnotizable category who can do three or less, kind of, or three or fewer suggestions. Everybody else falls somewhere in that 80% in the middle, and we're all moderately hypnotizable if we're in that bracket. So these are the results you get with traditional approaches to hypnosis. And by traditional approaches to hypnosis, I mean a good pre-talk that alleviates the fear, enlists cooperation, that sort of thing, an induction that takes a bit of time and is applicable to most people, maybe it might be relaxation based, and a set of typically worded suggestions. So this is a very standard kind of approach to hypnosis. Wouldn't look out of place. So what is going on? Is always a good question. Well, Kilstrom's a social cognitive theorist. He noted that hypnosis relies on the use of imagination in no uncertain terms. Pretty clear. He's right. If you can see Michael Jackson dancing, it's clearly imagined. There's no other way he's going to be there. He also noted that, and this is the important bit, good hypnotic subjects have no better skills of imagination, as rated on any of the standard academic scales of these sort of things, than poor hypnotic subjects or anybody else. So one thing we can take from that is that if hypnosis relies on imagination, and we've all got, you know, we'll have a different level of response to suggestibility, it's not because our imagination's crap, because we know our imagination's good enough. It's something else in the way. So if hypnosis uses the imagination, the subjects are imagining, what is it they're imagining? in terms of big arm-wavy kind of classes. So I'll explain what these are. Means imagery, referred to in the academic world as goal-directed fantasies, or GDFs, these are the balloons of an arm levitation. These are the glue of a hand stick. It's where you say, your hand is stuck, imagine the glue. You say, your arm's going to rise, imagine there's balloons attached pulling it upwards. Yeah? They are the means imagery. If they're true, then the goal of the suggestion will also be true, because the balloons would lift your arm, or the glue would hold your hand down. Goal imagery, on the other hand, is imagining the goal of the suggestion. So for an arm stick, it's imagining that your hand is stuck and can't be lifted. For an arm levitation, it's imagining that your arm is going to rise up and touch your face. These are the two kind of opposite kind of ways of looking at imagination. Now, goal-directed fantasy, means imagery, appear in traditionally worded suggestions. So when people generally give suggestions, they're generally banging on about the balloons, about the air that's blowing the hand up, etc., etc. So there's a paper by Gail Comey and Irving Kirsch. Irving Kirsch is one of our heroes, by the way. I did have originally introductions to all these academics in my talk, but my talk was far too long because of it. But I'll just say Irving Kirsch is a hero. He's a great guy. We met him last year at Change Phenomena. He did some mad things. Definitely look up his work, especially his work on placebo. I'll plug his book, The Emperor's New Drugs. It demonstrates antidepressants do not work. Or rather, explains why they work. So, in an experiment, Comey and Kirsch took 259 novice subjects who had never been exposed to hypnosis before. They were college students. They split them into two groups, randomly. One group got the KERS, which is a hypnotic scale, the Carleton University Responsiveness to Suggestion Scale. It's got 7 suggestions on it. Using that scale, you can measure how responsive someone is to suggestion. The other half got a modified version of the KERS. And in the modified version, they took out all references to goal-directed fantasy. So as an example, an arm levitation suggestion had the phrase, in the original it has, imagine that your arm is like a balloon. Imagine that air is being pumped into it, making it feel lighter and lighter. That was replaced by, lighter and lighter, the arm is becoming more and more light, and is rising, rising, moving up, higher and higher. So simply, it's gone back to suggestions for the goal, rather than making you imagine the balloon. Yeah, so in the first one, it's imagine the balloon, imagine the air, pumped up, etc. And the second one, it's just lighter and lighter, as in, it is going to rise. Now, this bubble here at the bottom is showing whether or not people actually produced goal-directed fantasies on their own accord. If they sat there imagining the means that would cause this, the balloon, etc. And in the instruction group of those that had the standard KERS, the no instruction group, the ones who didn't have the instructions from either of those GDFs. So in this bottom bubble, you can see that significantly less people imagined the balloon if you don't tell them to imagine the balloon. That's usually worth noting. But the big ones are the two bubbles at the top. The 209 that jumps to 275, the 634 to 750, the 115 to the 161, even the 130 to the 165, which is a little bit less significant. But what you're seeing is that when you don't instruct them to imagine the balloons or the glue, they become more responsive. The first score, the KERS-O, is the objective score. That's whether the behavior occurred. So for an arm levitation, the arm lifted is the behavior occurring. So more people had the effect in terms of behavior when they weren't told to imagine GDFs. The KERS-S is the subjective rating. That's, did they feel the effect of the suggestion? So as in, did they feel that their arm was lighter and rising? More people did when you don't tell them to imagine the balloon. Involuntariness. Did it feel like they had no control over this? And yeah, again, that jumps a significant amount. But basically, the point I want to make here is that when you don't instruct people to imagine the balloons, which is the thing that we all do, because that is the traditional way to give a suggestion, they become better subjects. Their rostrum increases in size. Clearly not. I mean, come on. There's not going to be a picture of the brain in this. Well, there might be, you know. The conclusions they drew, subjects have to do something for hypnosis to happen. If you're telling your subjects or your clients to just sit there and allow hypnosis to occur, you will get lower results than if you sit there telling them you have to do something. Simply doing something is better than doing nothing. Doing nothing is massively negatively correlated with response. So tell them to do things. Intentionally imagining the goal-directed fantasies is also negatively correlated with response. It's not just that it does nothing, it actually damages your suggestions. Stop doing it. It's silly. But this does turn suggestion on its head. As I say, traditional suggestions always ask subjects to imagine these goal-directed fantasies. It's all about the balloons and the glue. And that's just not the way suggestions should be given, according to this research. One reason why this might be is that if you have to put attentional effort into imagining the goal-directed fantasy, that's attentional effort that you could have been putting into succeeding at the suggestion. It might just be that there's less effort to go around, and therefore your brain just doesn't quite succeed at it. The only other thing to point out is that spontaneous goal-directed fantasies did occur. So when you don't instruct people to imagine them, they can occur spontaneously. And if you ask the person, they'll say, oh, no, I didn't intentionally imagine that. It just appeared. There were balloons there that I wasn't intending to imagine. That turns out to be extremely rare, and it's correlated with highly hypnotizable subjects. But it appears to be an effect of suggestion as opposed to a mediator or a mechanism that causes it. So goal-directed fantasy, not a good idea. A priest, a rabbi, and a vicar walked into a bar. The barman said, is this some kind of joke? No, clearly not. So what about goal imagery? This table shows what activities a successful subject were engaging in when they were succeeding at passing suggestions. We'll ignore most of the columns, but we focus on the goal image. This is goal imagery, so it's imagining the goal. So for arms rising, imagine your arms going to rise. So arms apart, imagine your arms are going to get apart, etc. Literally imagine the point, the goal of the suggestion. What you see is that it's highly correlated. People who pass those suggestions in the 70 to 80% kind of area were imagining the goal of the suggestion, or were reported imagining the goal of the suggestion. The amnesia line has a little note, there's a little A next to it. Unfortunately, they asked a different question. They asked, did people try to forget, as opposed to asking, did you imagine you had amnesia? We might have had a different number if they'd have asked that question, we don't know. So, imagining the goal of a suggestion is correlated with feeling the effects of the suggestion. Which is good if you want people to feel the effects of what you're doing, especially in therapy, you generally be a felt thing. This means that imagining the goal of the suggestion is a good strategy. It's something that you should tell clients or subjects to do, because it massively improves their results. The second quote here indicates that this works equally well across all phenomena. So the paper, one of the papers that its original idea was based around was looking at a two-factor model of hypnosis, the idea being that there's two factors and a combination of these two factors determines your responsiveness to suggestion. That was shown to be a load of rubbish. They also showed that absorption, you know, how likely you are to get absorbed in things, no impact on hypnosis. What was the other one? Fantasy proneness, how likely you are to enter into fantasies. No, I mean, the two combined achieve 2% of the variance in hypnotic response. They just don't really have any impact on whether or not people are hypnotizable or responsive to suggestion. But this was interesting because here was a mechanism that not only had some big numbers associated with it, but which worked across the board. So it was just as applicable to hallucinations as it was to catalepsy. But is it enough? Is imagining enough? I mean, that's a good question. You see it banded around the internet, people talking about this. You know, it's just imagination, that's not hypnosis. Well, maybe. Several's pendulums, quite a good idea. If you take a pendulum and you imagine that it's going to move forwards and backwards in a straight line, then it does. And if you imagine it's going to move around in a circle, you keep on imagining, and it does. So What's going on there? Your mind is imagining something, your body is causing the muscle movement required to achieve the effect that you've imagined, without you being aware that you are moving your muscles. I mean, intellectually you might be aware you're moving your muscles, because how else would this stuff occur? But you can't feel that, you're not aware of the actual movements of those muscles as they occur, yet you are directly responsible for them. Some process in your brain starting with imagination has ended up with that pendulum moving. I'm pretty sure your muscles were involved in that. So here we've got the Stroop effect, which Kirsch talked about last year, but I'll quickly run through it. You've got words appear on a black background in different coloured inks, one at a time. You have four buttons under your fingers for the four different colours, red, blue, green, yellow. You push the colour matching the ink colour of the word. So here it would be red, blue, yellow, green. Now, when you do the Stroop effect, a word like blue, written in the ink of the word, you tend to get quicker. You tend to be able to respond faster to that. A word printed in red ink that says green, you tend to be slower at, because your automatic brain is automatically reading those words, and you tend to make mistakes, you tend to catch those mistakes. It takes you longer to ascertain that that is red that you should be pressing in that situation. And neutral words, Stroop effect, take somewhere in between the two. With suggestion, not hypnosis, not induction, but with suggestion alone, in highly hypnotizable subjects, you can reduce the effect of the Stroop effect. That's pretty powerful stuff, because nobody else seems to be able to do that. On the right-hand side here, we've got our head hacking research logo, as printed on Marcus's arm, in King Ink, Las Vegas, 2 years ago. Under hypnosis. It took an hour, I know, because I stood there and filmed it. He moved once to scratch his nose with his other hand. But during that period of time, he wasn't aware that he was being tattooed, he didn't feel the pain of the tattoo, and interestingly, and I thought Adam would find this, expects this to be the case, he didn't bleed, which really surprised the tattooist. I mean, it's not a small tattoo, it's about this sort of size. And all that had been wiped away was ink, no blood. Can you do these things with imagination? Just imagine it. Well, possibly. There is some evidence to suggest that you can. But it would, if you're just using everyday imagination, it would feel like it wasn't involuntary. It'd feel like you're doing that. The moment you stop doing it, the effect stops. So it feels like it has effort involved in it. And these aren't kind of the hallmarks of hypnotic responding. It should be effortless. It should be involuntary. So something else must be required. It's difficult, isn't it? When you're the captain of a ship and also a moth. You can see the lighthouse. You know you shouldn't. You just can't quite help yourself. So we're talking about involuntariness. There's a very tenuous link, obviously, with every joke. And if you spot them all, you win a little prize. You win a little prize. You can take your pick. Badge or needle, that's you. So, John F. Kilstrom, social cognitive theorist, he agrees. This is his quote. He makes it quite clear: the sensation of involuntariness is key to hypnosis. Woody and Sadler, who could represent the dissociative theories from everything from Hilgard's near dissociation through to dissociative control theory and potentially cold control theory, they agree as well. They say it shouldn't come from you. Kind of implies it's involuntary. And so do Kirsch and Lynn, who popped up on Adam's slide. I took a photograph of that slide. It's very impressive. In their description of response set theory, they discuss involuntariness in exactly the same way. They point out, in the first part of the quote, it's an illusion. But they point out, in the second part of the quote, it's an illusion we need to understand. But they go further. They draw on the Libet experiment, which challenges free will. It's an amazing experiment. There's a video. This, if you write this down, I mean, there are slides. Clearly, aren't being given out. There will be a set of slides to pick up on exit if you want. There's this No Free Will, Not Long.com takes you to a YouTube video of Marcus de Soitoy, who is the professor for the public understanding of science at, I believe, Oxford University. He's in a brain scanner. He has to choose between this button or this button. And the guy outside the brain scanner watching his brain can tell 6 seconds before Marcus can tell which button he'll push. Do you talk about this? Well, Kershaw suggests that everything we do is automatic based on that, or based on that experiment. In neuroscience, I mean, I've read Sleights of Mind recently by two neuroscientists who are becoming magicians. They refer to this as practically fact in neuroscience, as possibly the most factual thing in neuroscience, is the fact we have no free will. It's worth bearing in mind. They suggest that everything we do is automatic, and that we then label that post hoc with the sensation of intention. So I walk around the stage, someone questions whether I'm meant to do that. I say, well, of course, because I'm talking. That's the sort of thing I do when I talk. But they see the actions as involuntary and the labelling of intention as an illusion. And it's the illusion of conscious awareness or illusion of consciousness. You're not really in control. It's just an illusion that your brain creates for you to give you that sense that you are in control. In their mind, response to suggestion is unusual, not because it adds a layer of involuntariness to a suggestion, but because it removes a hallucinated, illusory layer of fake intention that's been added. The idea with hypnosis is that you're seeing your automatic actions for what they are, whereas normally you only get to see the illusion that you could have done something about it. So, at this point, we have a quick recap. So the recap, goal imagery is a good strategy if you want to succeed at passing suggestions. And there's no reason to think bad subjects have worse imagination skills than good subjects. Okay? Pretty straightforward. Quick recap, automaticity. We are automatons presented with an ongoing illusion of consciousness and agency. No matter how much it feels like you have conscious control, you don't. Just an illusion created by your automatic brain. Altering this illusion can cause your actions to be perceived as happening automatically or involuntarily. So while we're imagining the effect of a suggestion, which we know will help us feel those effects of that suggestion, it's not that we need to create a sense of involuntariness, because everything's involuntary anyway. It's that we need to remove the sensation of intention that's been ascribed to the action as part of this illusion. They'll put up the automatic brain. That is a good joke. Two hydrogen atoms are in a bar talking. One says to the other one, I think I've lost an electron. The other one says, really? Are you sure? He says, yes, I'm positive. Amazing how science jokes go down. Clearly this isn't a hydrogen atom, but the visual reference was close enough for me to steal that joke from Jimmy Carr. In pictorial form, the green-yellow bit is your automatic brain doing automatic things. The white part of the slide is your body, essentially. Easiest way to think about it. The awareness bit, the yellow bit in the middle, is generated automatically by the green bit. So, to talk through, the brain senses the environment. Light comes in through your eyes, sounds through your ears, skin, whatever. Generates an imagined reality based on what it knew from the past moment and what new information it's gained. Squirts that imagined reality into a process which it creates and runs automatically for you called awareness, which generates its own imagined vision, sounds, sensations, etc. They all get combined, and out comes action in the form of muscle movement, hormone production, emotion, etc. And the whole thing continues, because obviously it's all interrelated. But it's quite a simple model. This permanent amnesic barrier I'm referring to here is more of a take the piss out of this neo-dissociation theory, which uses amnesic barriers to separate consciousness into multiple streams. In neo-dissociation theory, one part of your consciousness does the suggestion, another part of your consciousness notices the effect of the suggestion and is surprised by it because there's this amnesic barrier between the two, stopping the bit that's aware from seeing the actions that caused the suggestion. And they call those amnesic barriers. It's a nonsense argument. It's been ripped to pieces by many people, including Irving Kershaw, Steve J. Lynn, as well as William Bowers, who are on that side of the fence in the dissociation kind of camp. But basically, 23% of people can achieve suggested amnesia. 75% of people can achieve manic palms. According to neo-dissociation theory, you need an amnesic barrier to succeed at any suggestion. So we would say that the 75% of people who are achieving magnetic palms are doing so using a mechanism that only 23% of people can produce with suggestion, i.e. amnesia. So it's all a bit silly. So, but I did get asked a question by someone who knew what they were talking about, so it kind of made its way into the picture. The amnesic barrier is essentially between your awareness, your reality, and the rest of your brain that's doing stuff. You can't see your reasons for why you did things or why you thought stuff. All you can do is guess at that, a process called confabulation, from within awareness. So your reasons that you conclude for why you did stuff is made up based on what's in that bubble of awareness, in that imagined reality. So if you look at the effects of imagining, imagine that the hand is stuck, occurring automatically in the automatic bit of the brain. It sticks into awareness the idea that your hand is stuck, and you can do this. If you imagine that your hand is stuck and continue to imagine that your hand is stuck, the ideomotor effect will work, supposedly, in 95% of you, and you'll find that while you continue to imagine that, your hand will be stuck. Now, clearly, you'll also know you can stop imagining that at any point, and your hand won't be stuck, and you can do that in the blink of an eye. Simply by needing your hand while wanting to do something else. Stop that process of imagining the hand stops being stuck. The other thing is, of course, you're also aware. That's the point I'm making. You're aware that you're imagining that. But if we also ask someone to imagine that they're not aware of imagining that their hand is stuck, then we can use the ideomotor effect on the brain to delete that piece of awareness. Because by imagining it, it becomes real to you in the moment while you're imagining it. Normally, as I say, you can stop imagining at the drop of a hat, which is why it's not a very scary thing to do. Why it feels like a very everyday thing to be able to do, to imagine stuff and not imagine stuff. But that's because you know you're imagining. You have awareness of that process. So the moment we delete that process, that awareness, your hand ends up being stuck and you can't put it off. You don't know why. And it seems, it appears, anyway, from our testing, that being aware that you're imagining that you're not being aware of imagining, which I know sounds a little bit like Inception, but bear with me. But apparently this piece of awareness doesn't provide the link to be able to jump back to the hand is stuck. You don't seem to be able to backtrack from the hand is stuck to what you did to cause it to be stuck while you're imagining this. It seems to take that step that out of the way. Now sometimes, I say sometimes, this happens quite a lot. In fact, it didn't happen enough for Gary because Gary was wanting to say yes, so it's probably where Gary was headed. You end up with a reminder that you're imagining. These things occur. You know, you do this process and someone ends up sort of going, you go, can you lift your hand? And they go, yeah. And how did you know you could lift your hand? And they will refer to being reminded. Maybe not in those terms, maybe you need to push that a bit. But generally it'll be, well, voice in my head, I just knew. Tell when I felt that, but I just knew. But generally there's a reminder. Generally they can articulate what they believe in the moment was the thing that was stopping them from having this experience, which was reminding them about the fact they were imagining. Now that might all be confabulation as well, and it probably is. But if they do give you a report, there's things we can do with it. This leads us into higher order thoughts. There's a slight tangent. So higher order thoughts are thoughts about awareness, whereas lower order thoughts are the thoughts that are awareness, essentially. So probably not a very good definition, but Don't worry. Simply having thoughts about thoughts, or simply having thoughts about a situation, are higher order thoughts. And apparently there's a hierarchy of this sort of thing, and there's some quite interesting ideas around how thoughts could be higher or lower than others. One of the things they point out is that we're not aware, generally we're not aware of lower order thoughts. The actual things that, which is kind of true, that's kind of like your brain is automatic and you don't have access to that stuff outside of your awareness, they are all the lower order thoughts. You simply don't have access to the awareness of them at all. But you do to higher order thoughts, which is where you exclaim stuff like, I can't lift my arm, is a second order thought, a higher order thought. This leads on to, because you're going to want to know, why am I talking about higher order thoughts? Well, they call higher order thoughts HOTs, as in H-O-T. And out of the back of that fell cold control theory, where someone clearly had a sense of humour. Maybe not a good one, but they clearly had one. So it's essentially removing accurate but obstructive higher order thoughts. So the ones that go, yeah, but I know I can lift my hand. Yeah, but I know I'm not hypnotised. It's like, take those out of the way. And it's a case of inserting higher order thoughts that might be inaccurate, but might be useful. I can't, yeah, my hand's stuck. I can't lift my hand. If he looks at me like that, I'll be hypnotised. Those kind of thoughts. And there's a whole theory based around cold control theory, which explains a lot of hypnosis. It doesn't rely on state. Doesn't rely on a special process. You can rework it into response set theory quite easily. It's not a bad little area. But what's interesting about it is that reminders are higher order thoughts. They're probably accurate. We know they're obstructive, but they are probably higher order thoughts. So there are ways of dealing with them. One way is to imagine them away. Imagine that's not the case. And we can use the same process we've just been through in order to delete that information from our reality. We're left with an awareness of imagining away the reminder, but again, that doesn't seem to be something that gets in the way for a subject. Another thing we could do is increase emotion using the human givens idea. If you haven't read Human Givens, there's a book, £10 or something on Amazon, it's brilliant. Their website, HGI, provide a lot of information. But one of the things in Human Givens is that they refer to past trauma, anxiety, phobia, etc., as being the experience of it in the moment is one of a large dump of emotion, and that emotion in the brain changes the way we think. It changes the higher order thoughts that are available to us. They generally swing to the extremes. You know, the person with spider phobia could, when there aren't any spiders, I have no honesty. I'm just such a good actor. If there's not a spider and you ask them about their spider phobia, then they'll give you lots of good, rational stuff. They'll point out that they're tiny, in this country they're not dangerous, generally. They could kill it quite easily, they could probably walk away from it faster than it can run. They live on flies, they can't hurt humans. You know, there's a whole load of rational things they'll come up with. And they'll end it with, they'll go, but I know, I just know that I'm scared of spiders. And then you provide them the spider, and they freak out. And the only real thoughts they have access to at that point is, oh my God, I'm going to die. You know, it becomes a shrieking, scared, you know. And you're like going, yeah, but it's tiny. And they're like, ah! Yeah, but you can walk away from it faster than it can run. And those rational thoughts don't seem to get through. They seem to focus on these extreme, irrational thoughts. And the difference between, it's not that they didn't have the phobia and now they have the phobia, because they had the phobia when they were being rational before the spider was there. It's that in the presence of that stimulus, this emotion appears and that changes the way they think. It's quite a powerful idea, because they then do stuff to try and remove some of that emotion. But from our point of view, we could use these ideas to tack the reminders. So we're in this situation where they're being reminded, they can lift their hand. We can imagine it away. Imagine not being aware of that reminder. Whatever it is, they can imagine not being aware of it. And it will delete the reminder. If we did it again with emotion, you change how important those higher order thoughts are. Change the significance of them. I don't know if you can see my amazing animation there. To the point where those other thoughts just don't seem to register. They just seem to disappear. And emotion does seem to make a massive difference to some of the stuff we've been doing with this. if people are prepared to freak out, then they do seem to get a bigger response, a bigger effect. And with the way we're working with this, once you have that response, there's no way back. So they're kind of trapped in that world, which is very, very useful as a hypnotist to give a suggestion that they can't then go ahead and defeat. This leads us into the trance killer suggestion. The trance killer suggestion is a reversal of the automatic imagination process that I've just been talking about, this idea of imagining things and imagining away the awareness. What it does is it returns the subject's awareness to the fact that they're imagining these things, and it reminds them that they don't have to, that they've got control over whether they imagine those things. Yet, it kills all automatic imagination in an instant. You just have to say it and it's dead. The effect is over. But it also kills hypnosis set up using traditional methods. So you can hypnotise someone, pretty much as I hypnotised Paul. In fact, you may have seen me trance kill it at the end of that session. I hypnotised Paul, experienced some suggestions, and the last line I said was, it's just your imagination, you can stop imagining that anytime you want, can't you? And he did. Stopped. He knew my name, his hand came off his head, everything was back to normal. I didn't say wake up, I didn't count to five, perhaps I should have done. Wake up! Wide awake?
Wide awake.
Excellent. If you imagine that you're not, just remember it's just your, yeah. If this works on all forms of hypnosis, and in our tests, which admittedly are quite limited at this point with the trance killer, but in our tests it has not failed, then it would imply that all forms of hypnosis are set up around imagining things, which seems pretty reasonable because a lot of the theorists agree on that. But imagining things in such a way that they become automatic and involuntary by simply imagining away that awareness. Now, if all forms of hypnosis get killed by the trance killer, then they must be in the same form as automatic imagination. There's no other good reason why a single line suggestion would kill all the effects of a somnambulistic trance with catalepsy and amnesia and all the other stuff that's going on. Pretty much in the time it takes to say one sentence. And if it is, it would imply that everything beyond instructing the subject to imagine in a particular way is just ritual and unnecessary. You probably don't need it. So if we look quickly at the trance killer in action, so there was a suggestion, the hand is stuck, stick in the trance killer, and it literally brings back that awareness that they're imagining. Once they're aware and they've been reminded they don't need to imagine, that process stops, and of course the effect stops instantly as a response. I'll quickly run through this. There are five types of people in the world, those that can count and those that cannot. But in our own informal counting, we've tested this on over 200 subjects, and the figures we're getting are 95% to a challenge, as in stuck hand, 90% to amnesia, we think we can improve on that. No inductions, no trance, no hanging around. This can all be done in under a minute. You can go straight to hallucinations. You don't need to go through. And also, because of that stat from earlier on from the Kirsch and Comey paper about how imagination, goal imagery, seems to be as applicable to all types of suggestion, then what you get from that is that you don't need to go through any kind of racking up or any phasing. It's, you know, you can start with catalepsy if you want, but you might as well just start with an hallucinated dog or amnesia. It's just as likely to work. We've got a formal experiment planned where we'll test this. So in summary, we talked about subjective experience with a live subject. We talked about traditional approaches and the stats you get. We looked at imagery, goal-directed fantasy versus goal imagery. We looked at involuntariness, turned that into automaticity when we realised that everything's involuntary anyway, and that all those other theories that are based on adding involuntariness clearly aren't correct. And then we looked at automatic imagination and how that works, and finally we ended on the trance killer. If the trance killer works as it appears to, then we will all need to reinterpret how we understand hypnosis and what we think it is. And we'll probably need to conclude that the elusive hypnotic state, trance, or special process is and always has been just a figment of our collective automatic imagination. Thank you. I'd now like to introduce Marcus Lewis, who's going to give a demonstration of automatic imagination in action. So, Marcus Lewis.
Patrick, yes? Yes. Excellent. I'm just going to get you to do this for me. Could you just write your name in here for me? Patrick, is that spelled correctly?
Yes.
Excellent. Just whack that in your pocket for me. Excellent. Thank you very much. So, I'm going to start. Can I borrow your hand? Is that all right? I'm going to place that right there. Excellent. And all I'd like you to do, can you imagine your hands are stuck together? You can imagine that. Are you imagining that now? But you know you can just pull them apart, obviously, because you're just imagining that, yeah? Okay, let's try this again. This time, imagine there is nothing you could do to pull those hands apart. Imagine they stick tighter and tighter. And you can already feel that, right? Try and pull them apart now. Realize they stick and lock tighter. Are you trying? Confirm to the audience you're trying to pull these apart. Really try. Put some effort in. Try harder. Excellent. Are you trying to pull those apart? Really? Confirm. Yeah, you're trying. How does that feel now? Obviously, this is just your imagination. You can stop imagining that anytime you want, and they come straight apart. Excellent. I wrote your name on a bit of paper, yeah? In your pocket. You just remove that for me a second. Excellent. Okay. And that's your name. Clearly states your name. It is all I wrote on here. I'd like you to imagine that when I tear this up, your name just goes from your mind. It just happens automatically. There's nothing you can do to recall that name. If I asked you what your name was and it just vanished, what was your name? My name's Marcus. Lovely to meet you. Really try and get it. Really try and think about it.
I know my second name.
You know your second name. We're trying to get your first name. You can stop imagining that and it just comes straight back, doesn't it? Comes straight back to your mind. You didn't feel hypnotized at that point?
No, not at all.
Okay, usually the way I perform this, I don't mention the word hypnosis. I usually perform as a magician. Thank you for doing that for me. Imagine there is nothing you can do to move your feet now, yeah? Imagine the harder you try and move your feet, the harder they stick to the floor tight. Automatically, the harder you try and move, they stick tighter and tighter. By the way, just for purposes of the audience, this is round two, because I tried to get him before with this, and he breached my traditional hypnosis. I done the induction. So this, I hold some money. The harder you try and move your feet, the harder they stick. Try and walk to me and take the money. Are you trying to move now?
Yes.
Try as hard as you possibly can. Are you trying to move now? Try hard, really try. Excellent. That's one up. For the automatic imagination model. Excellent. Thank you. You can stop imagining that. Everything goes back to normal. You feeling good? Excellent. Take a seat. Give them a round of applause, guys. Thank you very much. Excellent. Just grab someone else. One more person. You've wet yourself. Okay, excellent. Imagine you couldn't stand up from that chair. You don't need to come up. Just imagine there's nothing you could do to stand up. Are you imagining that now? Yeah? Obviously, you know you're just imagining it, so you could stand up if you tried, right? You could stand up, yeah? Imagine there is nothing you can do. This happens automatically. If you tried to stand up now, you would stick tighter and tighter to that chair. I really want you to put some effort in and try and just confirm that. Are you trying to stand up now? Just confirm to everyone so everyone can hear that you are trying to stand up, yeah? This.
Yeah, back to the seat.
You are not hypnotized and you cannot stand up out of your chair, just to confirm. Is that what's happening?
Yeah,
just to confirm to these guys. Some people might not be able to see it from where they are. Are you trying to stand up, really trying? Excellent.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
We'll get the money out. I'll try again.
When I spoke to Patrick, he couldn't remember his name.
Yeah.
Can you imagine what that would be like for you to experience that?
Yeah.
Try and say your name now.
Yeah.
Yeah? Excellent, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you. I hope you got something out of it. Thank you. By the way, you can stop imagining that anytime you want. It just comes straight back.